I'm really happy to be giving this talk here. I complained many times that sometimes at PHP conference they only talk about PHP, which makes sense, it's a PHP conference, but I think we also need to open their minds to other topics. Yeah, so the title is a bit long, it's what we talk about when we talk about distributed systems, but by the colors you can guess it can be called distributed systems for the IKEA family. So this is the IKEA catalog of distributed systems. So this topic, my computer maybe lost like a core because it's very slow. The definition of distributed systems is a distributed system is one in which the failure of a computer you did not even know existed can render your own computer unusable. That's the definition from Leslie Lamport, which is the pioneer on the field. Basically, this is when in the internet we say Facebook is down, the whole internet is down, or GitHub is down, we can't work anymore, or last night Slack was down and nobody could work either. I don't know if you saw it, that Slack went down yesterday. I mean, that's kind of a joke, but yeah, in distributed systems, it's not just having like in parallel programming, when you just distribute tasks in parallel and you kind of don't care what happens. In this case, if some of these other computers fail, yours or the one taking part of the job fails as well. And the problem I had when I started learning about distributed systems is that there is a lot of jargon, a lot of terminology, and this terminology, even if it has the same words as the one we use in other parts of computer science, they don't mean the same in the distributed system literature. So in a distributed system, we have many entities which are trying to solve a problem. They could be called nodes or processes. These nodes have partial knowledge of what's happening in the whole system. And there is a degree of uncertainty. You never know what the other node in the system knows, basically. So, and when you start to trying to learn, you will find that it's a very deep rabbit hole. You have no idea what to read. For example, which papers? You will find on the internet people that are very well known in the distributed system community, and they will tell you, if you don't know this paper or that paper, you will fail, basically. But why? Why should you learn about the CAP theorem or the FLP impossibility or Paxos, RAF, SAV, you name it? Why? What will this bring into your daily job, let's say? That was a question I asked myself all the time. Like, people saying, you need to learn about FLP. Okay, what even is FLP? French, Liege, and Paris, I don't know. What is FLP? So, there is this paper, Impossibility of Distributed Consensus with One Faulty Process. This is FLP because one author is called Fisher, Lynch, and Patterson. That's the name, why this is called FLP. But that's the full title, actually. Then there is a part-time parliament, that's a Paxos paper. There is time clocks and ordering of event in distributed system. This is kind of the pioneer paper on distributed systems. Every talk, paper, and whatnot about distributed system will mention that paper, otherwise you probably are kicked out of school, I don't know. You don't get your PhD if you don't name it this. And it's from Leslie Lamport as well. A simple totally ordered broadcast protocol. This is what Zookeeper uses, comes from Yahoo. The protocol is called ZAV. In search of an understandable consensus algorithm, this is the RAFT paper. I don't know if you heard about RAFT. It's another consensus algorithm. So there are all these papers. Which one you should learn? Why? Who knows? Then there are books. There are way too many books. This is some I have at home. And just to give you an example, somewhere there, let me see the list. The first one on your left is called Programming Distributed Computing Systems. I wanted to learn how to program distributed computing systems. I bought that book. That book has nothing to do with that. The book is actually presenting different models in which you can encode distributed systems like P calculus, the IO actor model, whatever. And when it comes to the implementation, it's just using research languages from the MIT that nobody knows except the author of that book. It's cool, you will learn a lot of theory, but thank you very much. I could have saved some money with this. So it's really difficult. Like the art of multiprocessor programming, it will teach you a lot of having many CPUs and whatnot, but it's not the same as distributed systems. So I can keep ranting about this, but let's go with the talk. And the why. Why do you need to learn about distributed systems so you don't end up with this? The problem on distributed systems and the uncertainty is that these systems are really, I mean, maybe you can count how many times I say either distributed systems or systems, and then we can, I don't know, have a prize or something. The problem is it's so hard to test these systems, and they have to be proven mathematically that they will actually work, that the algorithms will terminate, that there is no deadlock somewhere in the algorithm and whatnot, that you don't invent your own consensus algorithm, let's say, because things will go very bad. When you was that particular situation, when that node was offline just for 2 milliseconds, but those 2 milliseconds weren't enough for another node to think the other one will break and whatnot, and yeah, you didn't think about that. So it's better to actually read literature than trying to implement your own distributed system thingy. And the problem, I mentioned the jargon. There are different models, so algorithms will fit one model or another, and the usefulness of the model depends on what problem you want to solve. It's hard, I can tell you. So there is the timing model, how the algorithms are grouped depending on this, the inter-process communication use between the nodes, and failure mode supported by algorithms. We will see each of them. Timing model. In timing model, there is the synchronous model and the asynchronous model. If you are, for example, following Node.js, you pretty sure have an idea what asynchronicity is, like stuff that is, instead of locking your thread, happens in the background. When this thing finishes, you get the result, something like that, let's say. Nothing to do with what asynchronous means in distributed systems, or what synchronous means here. It has nothing to do with that concept. The synchronous model is a model where each process has a definite and well-known time that it takes to execute one step on the algorithm. All the nodes take the same time to execute that particular step. There is a well-known time that a message takes in the network to go from one node to the other and this node to reply back. So in this model, for example, you know that if it takes 1 second for your message to arrive to the other process takes 1 second to process it and 1 second to reply to you. If it takes longer than 3 seconds, the other node is for sure dead. Of course, this doesn't map to reality because we have no idea how long a processor will take to execute a function. We have no idea what will be the network delay, network congestion, if the CPUs or the file system is congested, whatever. Synchronous model, not equal reality, let's say. And the asynchronous model is totally the opposite. We have no clue how long a message will take going through the network. We have no clue how long a process will take executing a step of the algorithm and how long it will take to reply. So, closer to reality, but not enough. And then there is the semi-synchronous model, where we have some assumptions between time, either by execution or for message passing, for example. So you may wonder, why do I even care about the synchronous model? Why do I have to read about that? Because if you prove that something is impossible with all the guarantees that the synchronous model is giving you, then you prove that this cannot be implemented in the asynchronous model, for example. If knowing for sure how long things take to execute, for example, you still cannot prove that this algorithm will terminate in the asynchronous model when you not even know if they will terminate at all, there is even harder to prove that the algorithm will work. That's the reason why there are all these many models, because this is all computer science, theory, mathematics. We like to spend long time filling whiteboards, and that's the idea, I guess. Inter-process communication, this is more familiar, I guess, is message passing or shared memory. You either share memory where the other process reads stuff, or you send messages. Failure mode. This is also interesting. There is a crash stop model. So when you read a paper, let's say you want to say we need to use Raft to solve whatever problem we have in our system. Depending on the failure mode that Raft supports is what you can achieve, basically, just to give an example. In the crash stop model, you have many processes. Whenever one of these processes crashes, is crash is gone. If in that algorithm that you are using, the algorithm supports that the process come back, then it's not this model. It's the crash recovery model, when some processes can become alive, like recover from a failure. But in some algorithm, the process, when they recover, they are actually considered to be a complete new process, even if it's the same computer, let's say the same physical server that came back to life. For those algorithms, if it's a crash stop, it's a crash stop. You have something new there. I have no idea what that is. And they will work in that with that idea in mind, these algorithms. Then there is the omission fault failure mode. In this case, a process can fail to either receive messages or to reply to messages. Why do you care? Like, if you have a caching system, a process fails to reply to others that it process requests, but it doesn't fail to receive requests. This means the state of the cache is up to date. You have a particular node that is failing to reply to the other nodes in the system, at least have an up-to-date state. So if you have an omission reply failure mode, your algorithm will still work correctly because that cache will serve non-stale data, let's say. So depending on what the algorithm supports is what you can do with that mode. And then the last one is the arbitrary failure modes. This is the Living La Vida Loca version, because here everything can happen. A node can impersonate other nodes in the network. It can reply whatever it wants that the other nodes are telling it. So it can say, a node asks me, let's say, ask that other node there, what's the value of X? This node replies to me, true. I reply false, because I want to mess up with the algorithm. Or I want to be as a node, assuming that I'm replying every request correctly, but I'm gathering data about what's happening in the system, AKA NSA, for example. So in this Byzantine failure mode, you have everything that you can possibly go wrong will go wrong. And it's really hard to implement algorithms that support Byzantine failures. So, again, you have all these things. Why do you care about crash stop or crash recovery or whatever? If it's proven that something is not even solvable in the crash stop model, it won't be solvable in the omission fault or arbitrary failure modes. So this mode also, like the next one, covers the failures of the previous one. Then algorithms, they talk about liveness and safety. There is a paper that introduces all this stuff in 1984. Safety is basically some bad thing does not happen during execution. For example, communication links should not invent messages out of thin air. It sounds like something that is really obvious, but in Erlang, you know this doesn't happen. You know Erlang doesn't introduce messages into the network in the things that are sent around. Maybe some other system does things that you don't expect, but are there. Liveness is the opposite, or kind of. It's a good thing happens during execution. For example, a destination process eventually delivers the message. You don't know when it will happen, but the algorithm assumes that at some point it will happen, and then they prove why it will happen or not. But yeah, for example, messages are not going to be waiting forever to be received at the other end of the network. So, with all these things we saw now, let's see what FLP is telling us. FLP says that it's an impossibility of distributed consensus with one faulty process. You know what is consensus in distributed system? Consensus is when many processes have to agree on one particular value. Let's say, let's commit a transaction to the file system, for example. So, the abstract is, the consensus problems involves an asynchronous system of processes, some of which might be unreliable. The problem is for the reliable processes to agree on a binary value, like true-false. We show that every protocol for this problem has a possibility of non-termination, even with only one faulty process, and whatever. But there you see, they are taking the asynchronous model into consideration. That's very important for something I will say later. In this paper, we show the surprising result that not completely asynchronous consensus protocol can tolerate even a single unannounced process death. We do not consider Byzantine failures, and we assume that the message system is reliable. It delivers all messages correctly and exactly once. This is super out of the real world, because exactly once reliable messaging systems, that doesn't exist, or it's really hard to achieve. But still, they put all these constraints on what they are trying to prove. Nevertheless, even with these assumptions, the stopping of a single process at an inopportune time can cause any distributed commit protocol to fail to reach agreement. Thus, this important problem has no robust solution without further assumptions about the computing environment or still greater restriction on the kind of failures to be tolerated. Whatever. More whatever. For example, some liveness property, every message is eventually delivered as long as the destination process makes infinitely many attempts to receive, blah, 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 blah. So, what's the point here? It's like, to understand what they are trying to prove in this paper, you need to understand what asynchronicity means, what all these messages guarantees mean, and so on. So it's not that it's impossible to solve consensus, because otherwise Paxos wouldn't exist, Raft wouldn't exist, Zav wouldn't exist. There are solutions to that, but they are saying that even with all those assumptions, if one process crashes, you cannot solve it unless you introduce other things to the system, which we will see soon. So what's consensus anyway? The consensus is a paradigm of agreement problems. Yeah, cool. It has some properties. This consensus termination, like every correct process in the system, eventually decides on some value. So the thing will terminate at some point. Validity, if a process decides V, then V was proposed by some process, like you cannot elect me as president of France because I will never be proposed, for example. You have to elect somebody that went to the election thingy. An agreement, not two correct process decide differently. And when you talk about uniform consensus, it means that not two process correct or not decide differently. So even processes that might have crashed, they reach at some point the same decisions as the other processes. Cool. So when do we need consensus? When a set of processes have to agree to take a common action, for example, atomic broadcast or group membership, or decide if you need to commit something to the file system and whatnot. Why do you care? Because tomorrow you will have a problem that may look like atomic broadcast or group membership. You have a cluster of things. You need to decide if this machine is part of the cluster. And then we are really smart. We don't need to read any papers. So we will start just implementing right away our group membership thingy, which will probably check MySQL, Redis, or whatever. Who cares? The point is, this is actually a consensus problem. And consensus problem for certain environments have no solutions. So we will be an endless loop of pull requests to our GitHub projects with patches and patches and patches that never solve the problem because we were too smart to ignore that the group membership was a consensus problem, for example. Atomic broadcast is the thing that when you have a group of processes, when one process receives a message, every other process received that message in that particular order. So how do you know that? How do you know that a database query was replicated to all the nodes in the system, for example? For that, you need consensus. you may want to hack this thing over MySQL or whatever, or let somebody that solved the problem on the higher scale solve it for you. Okay, this is atomic broadcast. Correct processes deliver the same set of messages in the same order. And FLP tells us that if consensus cannot be achieved, then atomic broadcast or group membership cannot be achieved either. So, pack your bags, go, nothing to see here. Actually not. There is a paper by a guy called Marcos Aguilera, which has the problem of he was working for Microsoft. That's not the problem. The problem is that all his papers went 404 once he quit Microsoft. So good luck finding that paper. Now I have it because I have a book where the paper is included. Anyway, he says that there are many misunderstandings when people read, like, there is an impossibility result in distributed system. You cannot implement consensus. No, that's not the thing. Impossibility results in distributed systems is not the same as in mathematics. For example, to give you an example to understand this thing, I could tell you that there is no integer bigger than 2. And you will say, but what? You never heard of the number 3? You don't count to 3 in Uruguay, you only 2. But I can say, I can add an extra note. If I consider the set of numbers 1 and 2, so by that, in that particular set, my assumption is true, that there is no greater number than 2. The same happens here. With all the assumptions on consensus, like asynchronicity, message system that don't drop any message, that they don't invent messages out of thin air, that and blah, 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 this cannot be solved. So if you have a system with those conditions, stop trying because it will fail. But to solve the problem, there's the introduction of failure detectors. A failure detector is a process that can tell if another process in the system has failed. There is a paper that explains all these kind of failure detectors. They are external processes to the algorithms. They provide information about suspected processes. They can tell the other processes if somebody died or not in this thing. And they have a completeness property, like crash processes are detected, and the accuracy is that correct processes are never suspected. So I ask you, do you think this is works in the real world? Anybody? Any takers? Nobody? Yes? No? Like? No like? There's a no like there. What do you need to know correct processes are never suspected? What would you need to be able to tell in a distributed system that you never suspect a process for not having failed? For example, you need to know exactly how long your message needs to travel in the network when you ping the other process. For example, you can start pinging processes. If they don't reply to you, they are crash processes. But to be accurate and never suspect a correct process, you need to know exactly how long the process takes to execute the ping, how long the ping takes to travel to the process, and the pong come back to you. Possible? Not possible. But this is why there is a joke that says, rub some perfect failure detector on it. Perfect failure detectors have all these properties, but require that you know, like in a synchronous system, you have these guarantees. So again, why do I even care? Why do you spend one page of the book printing this thing that just makes no sense? Because it's telling you, to implement this thing, you need those guarantees. You don't have them, don't bother trying to implement that thing. That's why there are the imperfect failure detectors, or eventually accurate. They have the strong completeness property. Eventually, every process that crashes is permanently suspected by every correct process. And eventual weak accuracy means that there is a time after which some correct process is never suspected by the correct processes. Translation, I was taken to the police, and after I showed my papers, they say, you can stay, basically. Like, I was suspected and not suspected anymore, right? So In distributed system, when you need to implement like consensus or whatever, you have a process that knows if after 60 seconds, let's say, after some timeout, the other process doesn't reply, it's considered to be dead, even if it's still alive. Sorry, that's the timeout we have in this system. You need to have these kind of trade-offs. The longer you have the timeout, the less you suspect correct processes, but the longer it takes for the algorithm to detect actual failures and to maybe stop starving. Maybe a process is waiting for another process to reach a decision, like replicate data or whatever. If you have the timeout too big, this will maybe wait 2 minutes for nothing. If you put it down to 15 seconds, then maybe you start suspecting too many processes that are actually working. What are the real world consequences? We have this question on the RabbitMQ mailing list all the time. What should I set the tick time in the network between Erlang nodes or between RabbitMQ nodes? How do I know if the other node is down? It's all these problems. There won't be a perfect way to solve it. It's a trade-off all the time. There is a paper there. You can go and take it. Then another thing they talk a lot in distributed algorithms is about quorums. The long story short is they are intersecting sets of processes. If I give you the mathematical description, I don't even understand what is written there, but it's a quorum in a system with n crash fault processes abstractions is any majority of processes. For example, any set of more than half processes. Cool. And if the F, because all these algorithms will say we tolerate F failures. Nice. If the number of failures is, if half the processes fail by crashing, there is always at least one quorum of non-crash processes in such systems. So you have at least half plus one that knows something, which in small letters for people like me, this is what it is. You have five processes in the system, and your quorum says that you only tolerate two failures. Let's see why we can only tolerate two failures out of five processes. Let's say at this point they reach some decision, whatever, or they update the state, and then B and D they crash. And then on the next execution, we have a new B and a new D. Then there are two more crashes, like C and E, for example. Then at the end, we have A being the only survivor from the previous execution, which still knows what happened there. And in this execution, where B and D were the only two new ones, C and E already know or learn what A knows. So the new B and D, they learn what A knows. And when we reach this point, again, A, B, and D, they know what happened. C and E are new ones. But still, the original thingy is still alive there. So when you have quorums and these kind of failures, for example, you don't need to replicate data to every process, or you don't need to wait till every process replies to you, because as long as three of them know, you know the thing will keep working as expected or stuff like that. So you may want, can I use Raft for my next project that needs consensus? Maybe. How many failures is Raft going to tolerate? How many machines are you willing to put online? And so on. You can see all that from this part of the algorithm description. Then there is consistency. You are following Kyle Kingsbury, Afir, on Twitter when he goes and says this database has this problem, or even RabbitMQ or whatever. Have you seen this blog post? The series is called Jepsen. Call me maybe. You know that? Yes, everybody in the room? Cool. So consistency is what he's trying to test. But there are many levels of consistency. And consistency here is not the same consistency you find in databases. I think the C in ACID, probably, and also the C in the CAP theorem. There are many C's, let's say. The first paper or kind of discussing this is called Linearizability, a Correctness Condition for Concurrent Objects, was presented in that paper. And when we discuss consistency, we need to discuss in the context of whatever data structure you want to have these properties. For example, imagine a concurrent FIFO queue, like first in, first out queue. You have an API that expects that things will go into the queue and they will come out in that particular order. If things come out in that particular order, even if there are many writers and many readers, then you have a concurrent FIFO queue that is consistent with what you expect from the queue API to work. The one that Kyle is testing for is atomic consistency or linearizability. There is also sequential consistency. There is causal consistency and many more. Kyle has a very good blog post describing each of these consistency conditions. For example, in Facebook, you want to see that your replies in order, and if you reply to somebody and he replies to you, you want to see his reply after yours, for example. But maybe if more comments come to your image, you don't care. You want to see like a logical way of how comments are arriving into your system, into your Facebook, sorry. But that doesn't have to be atomic consistency, which is really hard to achieve, has more overhead on the system. You can just get along, for example, with sequential consistency. But this is quite even deeper topic. And causal consistency, if some event causes another one, then you want to see this succession of things happening. But just to give an example of linearizability, it's like you have three processes doing stuff on the system, or implementing, in this case, a read-write register, like one variable, but it's with concurrent access. Linearizability or atomicity is that you have an overview, the line below of the system, like an external observer is looking at all the operations as they happen, and there is a linearizability point for all of them where they make sense, what it means that it makes sense. Operations, as you can see, like write two on the middle line and write three are concurrent because they don't finish they are happening while both at the same time, even the read at the top as well. So the first one, we wrote one and was serialized in that first point, is fine. So the second operation, read one, that's perfect. But what do we do with these three that are kind of concurrent there? The write three on the last process below was serialized first than the write two. That means that read must read two. It cannot read three, even though they were concurrent, because the serialization was that one. So for this serialization to be valid, this order has to be maintained. You could also have serialized the process in the other order. It can be serialized. The write two was first, write three was second, so this means this process, when it reads, it has to read three and not two and whatever. What Kyle is trying to find with Jepsen is if these histories, these linearizability or linearizable histories, can be found when he sends operations to Postgres, to Rabbit, to Cassandra, to whatever. This kind of things is what he's trying to find according to the concurrency of all the operations. To finish, I can tell you about some books in case you are interested in learning more about them, about it. This is a French researcher. So I'm pretty sure this is the one you prefer. I don't know. He doesn't write in French, so I'm sorry. The problem with this book is that, for example, I program in Erlang, so when I read a book on Amazon that says distributed algorithm for message passing systems, I can immediately say this is a book I need to buy because I work in Erlang, for example. No. Why? Because this book doesn't consider any failures. All the algorithms in this book have the happy path. There is no failures at all. This is so funny, we let's burn this book. No, because this book introduces like vector clocks, Lamport clocks, how to do spanning tree traversals on a distributed system, how to search for deadlocks, what is atomicity, what is linearizability, what. If you know all of that, then I'm pretty sure you don't need to learn this book. But in my case, I didn't know all of that thing, all of those concepts, so for me it was really helpful to get an idea of what's going on. And because it's using a message passing system, the pseudocode in this book is really easy to translate to Erlang, for example. And you learn about this when you reach the end of the book. He never says this on the back cover or whatever, so you have to buy the book to learn that there are no failure considered. Then the same author has fault-tolerant, agreement, asynchronous message passing systems. If you don't know what I've been talking about in the talk, is everything cool, fault-tolerant? Nice, Erlang is fault-tolerant, so probably need to write this thing or buy it. Message passing systems, yeah, I need it. But it's about synchronous systems. So all the algorithm here will be fault-tolerant, will work for message passing systems, but they assume you know how long it takes to send a message, to execute and step, and to reply back. So maybe not so useful in the real world. Then there is communication and agreement abstraction for fault-tolerant asynchronous distributed systems. So everything checks except the asynchronous part. Because asynchronous, again, you have no clue if something will even terminate. So if you need to introduce failure detectors, the failure detectors add this timeout thingy, for example, that will add some kind of synchronicity to the system. So you have a balance, and it will add work at the end, let's say. Then, this is kind of the Bible of distributed algorithms. I highly recommend this book. It has all these models as sections of the book. So if you know you have a completely asynchronous system, you can go to that part of the book. There is a semi-synchronous part, and so on. So it's very well organized. It's by Nancy Lynch, the L in FLP. So she's very well-known researcher on distributed systems. And she's the editor of all this series of books. So this one is also really good and smaller than this one. And the cool thing about this book is it also takes care of security. Most books don't care about how to authenticate peers in the distributed system. Like, they assume you have a cluster of nodes, everybody knows everybody, everybody's cool with everybody. Maybe that's not the reality. And this book, you can literally cut with a scissor the first half of the book and throw it away, but the second half, the first half is like COBOL and RPC and who cares, but the second part discusses all the different consensus algorithms that are like Paxos and Viewstan replication and many more. I'm not sure it's the right place to make this joke. I know I'm over time, maybe, but the problem this guy has today, he created a protocol in the 80s called ISIS. So today, you probably don't want to search for the ISIS protocol in Google. And that protocol was used in the 80s to control airplanes. This is like a bad joke, really. But anyway, this guy actually is one of the consensus protocols most used in the field during the 80s. Because I think in Java it's called JGroups or something like that. I have no idea what that is, but some person told me in a conference that JGroups is very famous technology. Cool. It's created by this guy, Biermann. And the thing is, back in the 80s, there was Lamport at one side, this guy on the other end, then there was Liskov, Barbara Liskov from the Liskov Principle. She implemented view-stamped replication. So there were many kinds of algorithms, all fighting for survival. Paxos is the one that we know more maybe today because of Lamport. View-stamped replication is very simple. It's like as simple as Paxos, but I'm not sure if it's too well used in the industry. And then there was this guy, which was kind of totally on the side, and yeah. He has a new protocol. I think it's called the ISIS-2 now, so I don't know. Anyway, this book is quite cool, the second part. And finally, this one about replication discusses all these kind of things, and it's the one that has the paper from the guy from Microsoft. And yeah, you can see there are, you think replication is just one thing? No, actually there are many definitions of replication, depending on what you want to do, blah, 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 blah. So as I say in the beginning, it's a very deep rabbit hole. Finding non-paywall papers. You probably know this, but all this ACM, or you have a subscription, or you don't get any paper. But many times, the authors in their university website or on their Microsoft page, they have their like a free PDF to the paper. Many times, you can just find them there, or even improved versions that are not on the ACM website. Conclusion. It's a deep rabbit hole, as I mentioned before. You probably got that already. What I like is computing science, where science is still a thing. So you have to prove things. You cannot just come and say, hey, I solved consensus, okay, but what happened with this result that happened in the 80s? What happened with Paxos, why you didn't implement Paxos, or blah, 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 blah. And you have to really document and defend why you have this new algorithm or this new result or this new whatever. Because the history of the field really matters here. It's not like you just jump with a new algorithm and get it to the top of Hacker News and then it's fine. No, that doesn't work like that. And yeah, we have to read a lot, basically. Not sure if we have time for questions. Yeah? Thanks.
Any? Yes, we do have time, and I'm sure there are many, many, many questions.
You better have one.
No? In the audience. Anyone? Yep.
Thank you for the speech. I'm still amazed about this kind of thing, because it's very, very far from what we do on the day-to-day life here in PHP, usually. But I was wondering, when it comes to that, if the blockchain, that is something that is come to be known now, which is the engine under
Bitcoin,
if it ever uses any of what you've been explaining so far, or if it stories something different?
I have no idea what's happening behind Bitcoin, but because you ask a question, you get a copy of the book.
But I don't know anything.
I don't follow. I'm from Switzerland. I have an agreement to only use Swiss francs in my life. So if I touch euros here, I need to wear gloves and stuff like that. So I can't do any Bitcoin. Sorry.
Okay, there's no more books to
give away, but maybe questions.
There's still time for a question.
Okay.
Well, I'd have one, considering all the failure scenarios you've just exposed and the difficulty to build up a fault tolerance system. How would you appreciate RabbitMQ right now?
Can we cut the camera there? So there is one colleague here from Rabbit. We are three persons in the team, and we have basically 66% of the team in your room. But the problem with Rabbit is that it implemented its own consensus algorithm, and is the source of most of the pain, I would say, when it comes to replication. And at the same time, it uses at some part of the system Nisha, which is a database from Erlang that doesn't tolerate too well network partitions. So those are the main problems, I would say, we have in that area. But at the same time, we are actually integrating already a Raft as part of the new version of replication, because we don't want any more not invented here solutions. So yeah, we have had like a huge source of bugs or race conditions or whatnot. We suffer all these things, basically. So in my particular point of view, I think we should go to the research. And this is a very difficult topic. For Lamport, for example, to get Paxos, he started in the 80s, and probably people started using in the early 2000s. And since maybe 4 years, 5 years, is that we hear about NoSQL databases, Paxos, RAS, whatnot. So if for a researcher, the job of his lifetime is to create, let's say, Paxos, I don't think any of us in the Rabbit team is smart enough to do in a 1 year, 9-to-5 job to have a correct distributed consensus algorithm. So what we are trying to do with the team is to move to Raft, for example, to try to get rid of and solve all these things that are happening. It's not like it will crash every day or have problems every day and whatnot, but when network partitions start happening, you may suffer the consequences. Kyle proved that under some conditions, Rabbit will lose messages, for example. And we have fixed many bugs there, but we haven't run the tests again. So I have no idea what the status is of, let's say, Rabbit today against Jepsen, which was run like a year and a half ago, maybe. So.
2013.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
I never say that. Just this is all an illusion. Like.
One last question.
Yeah.
Thank you. So more of the same, basically. I know the Jepsen guy had some kind of fight with Michele Sanfilippo from Redis, and Redis cluster is not yet out. Do you have any opinion about Redis cluster being out and how?
No, I don't comment on other technologies.
Fair enough.
I mean, for me, you need to, based on what the researchers are doing, there is a... for example, Lamport has a book or a system, but there is a book you can buy about this, about a language called DLA Plus, something like that. With DLA Plus, you can model your algorithm in this language and prove properties about your algorithm. I remember Kyle proving that the original, at least, implementation of the Redis cluster will fail, even mathematically. That your, let's say you have a thing that DL Plus approves, that your algorithm then is, the implementation is faithful to that, that's a different thing. But for example, I know that happened back then. I'm not sure what's the status today. I don't follow Redis either, but I would prefer to take something from the research that is proven and that is even proven in the industry, like either Raft or Paxos, but I wouldn't come up with some ideas of mine. I don't think you will reach a good destination.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Alvaro Videla, thank you very much.